So we've seen informally that the contrast sensitivity function looks something like this. And before we go into seeing some actual measurements of it, I want to talk more about spatial frequency. So this is measured in cycles per degree. Why degree? Well, in vision, what's relevant is visual angle always. When you go to the opticians and they measure the smallest letters that you can see, it's not very relevant to say, oh, can this person read letters that are 1 centimetre tall? Because the answer is going to depend how far away they are, right? You might be able to read letters 1 centimetre tall from 60 centimetres, so fairly close, but maybe not if you were viewing them from a distance of 6 metres. Why? Because 1 centimetre at 6 metres away is a very small angle. It's 0.1 degree, in fact, whereas 1 centimetre at 60 centimetres away is 1 degree. So it's a much bigger angle, and therefore you find it easier to see. So in vision, always what's relevant is the degree rather than another measurement of size such as centimetres or metres. So going back to our sinusoidal luminance gratings, when we assess their spatial frequency, we express that in the number of cycles that there are per degree. So here is one cycle of the luminance grating from light to dark and back to light again. That's one spatial period. I'm going to use the symbol lambda for that, which is traditional. Let's say this particular lambda is 2 degrees, then the spatial frequency is 0.5 cycles per degree. Okay, so let's look at a real contrast sensitivity function. This is some data from a classic paper by Campbell and Robson, 1968. And they're plotting Campbell's contrast sensitivity, so the reciprocal of his contrast threshold, as a function of spatial frequency in cycles per degree. And you can see it has this inverted U shape that we discussed. You can see that the contrast sensitivity peaks at around 3 cycles per degree. And the peak is around a sensitivity of 500. So 1 over 500, the threshold must be 0.002, or around 0.2%. So we peak here at around 3 cycles per degree, and then we have lower sensitivity for lower and also for higher spatial frequencies. And there are 2 different reasons for this. The fall off for high frequencies is really due to the eye's optics, the photoreceptor density, and so on. Clearly, it helps an animal, a species, to have good vision in general, so you can imagine we would like to be able to see higher and higher frequencies. But the trouble is there are costs associated with that. You have to evolve very precise optics in order to form a very sharp image on the back of the retina. You need lots and lots of photoreceptors in order to encode all the detail that you can see and transmit it to the brain. And what the acuity that we actually have reflects some kind of trade-off between the evolutionary benefits of having good vision versus the evolutionary costs of investing all that effort into having really good eyes and the neural circuitry to deal with interpreting the data that they give us. Acuity then is a word that's used to describe the sharpness of our vision, and in terms of the contrast sensitivity function, it reflects the spatial frequency at which our sensitivity falls to its minimum possible value. So a sensitivity of 1 means that we have contrast of 100% is needed in order that we can see gratings of that kind of detail. You can't go beyond a contrast of 100%, so for even higher frequencies, we simply can't see them at all. So the acuity is the highest spatial frequencies that we can see. And reading off this graph, 10, 20, 30, 40, you can see for us it's around 40 or 50 cycles per degree. Of course, it depends on the individual and on those other factors like luminance and so on that we mentioned. So when you go to the optician and they want to measure your acuity, they'll typically use one of these charts and they'll see what's the smallest letters that you can read. But in the lab, we really prefer the contrast sensitivity function with gratings as a more precise way of measuring that acuity. Now, the fall off at low spatial frequencies is rather different. It might seem like there's no particular reason why that has to happen. And it's believed to be due to neural processing such as lateral inhibition that I think you saw in the retina already, this central surround kind of arrangement. And the idea is that that makes our vision more efficient because it concentrates on changes. One of the factors which affects contrast sensitivity is where in the retina you're measuring it. So this particular contrast sensitivity function was measured at Campbell's fovea, where he has the highest acuity. If you measure it in the visual periphery, where we have many fewer cone photoreceptors, you can't see such high spatial frequencies. Now all this might be seeming rather abstract, so let's bring it back to a very practical everyday question: should you invest in a 4K TV? So to answer this question, we can actually answer this based on the human contrast sensitivity function. Suppose you measure your contrast sensitivity function and it turns out that the highest frequency you can see is 60 cycles per degree. So that's really good, you've got very good vision, absolutely at the upper end of what humans can see. Now, when you have a grating that is 60 cycles per degree, then what that means is one cycle is one arc minute. So a minute of arc, there are 60 arc minutes in 1 degree. So you can see then that 60 arc minutes is going to be 60 cycles, and you've got 60 of them in 1 degree. So the stripes are 1 minute of arc apart. And if the stripes of a grating are closer than 1 minute of arc, your visual system just can't see them anyway. So now we can ask, what pixel density do you need on your television in order to display all the detail that you are going to be able to see? Well, obviously, that depends on the viewing distance. So let's say this is the highest frequency that I can depict on my television screen. It goes from white to dark in 1 pixel. So the cycle is 2 pixels wide, okay? And if that's the finest detail that I can see, then because I know my visual acuity is 60 cycles per degree, this spacing, these 2 pixels, must be 1 minute of arc, or 1/60th of a degree. So clearly, if I go up really close to my television, I am going to be able to see those pixels and resolve that kind of detail. But of course, you don't view your fantastic widescreen 4K television from a few centimetres away. The Society of Motion Picture and Television Engineers recommends that you sit at a distance from which your screen subtends 30 degrees. And if you work that out, it turns out that the SMPTE recommended viewing distance is 1.87 times the pixel width. Okay, so if, as we've seen, 2 pixels subtend 1/60 degrees, then if you're sitting at the SMPTE recommended distance, then across the entire screen, we're going to have 2 × 60 × 30, or 3600 pixels. We could have more than that, but then the pixels would be closer together than 1/60th degree, and I wouldn't be able to see that level of detail anyway. So we're now in a position to say, is it worth buying a 4K television? So let's say I've got a standard HD TV at the moment, so that's 1920 pixels across the whole screen, a lot less than 3600. If I buy a 4K television, it's going to be 4096, comfortably above this limit. So yeah, it is worth buying a 4K television. It will display beautiful detail which my visual system will be able to detect, and so I'll be able to appreciate this enhanced image. But is it worth paying out the extra for 8K UHD? Well, then there's going to be 7,680 pixels across the screen, and there's really no point in that at all, because the increased level of detail is not something I'm going to be able to see from the kind of distance I probably want to sit at when I'm watching television. So there you go, that's an example of how vision science and the contrast sensitivity function can be useful in giving you principled answers to these kinds of display type questions. Now, we saw earlier that you can have the same contrast, say 50%, at several different luminances. So when you measure the contrast sensitivity function, you can choose what mean luminance you're going to use, about which you're going to vary the contrast. And that actually affects the results that you get. So that's shown here. What this shows is the contrast sensitivity function recorded at many different retinal illuminances. So in Trolands again. And the black symbols here are for the highest illuminance that they measured, and then as we go down through the colours, you're getting to lower and lower luminances. So in the bright light, you can see for this observer, they're seeing frequencies of around 5 cycles per degree, most clearly. I think it was 3 in the earlier plot, but you know, it varies between individuals, so anywhere between 2 and really 10 cycles per degree. That's what you'd expect in bright light. And then you've got the roll-off at lower and higher frequencies that we discussed. Now, what happens then as you lower the light? Well, two things. First of all, the peak sensitivity goes down, so we're less sensitive to contrast in dim light. Another interesting change, though, you'll see that that fall-off is most profound at the high spatial frequencies, and we're getting much less fall-off at the low spatial frequencies. So to summarise, in dim light, we're less sensitive to contrast overall, but especially at intermediate and high frequencies. And that's why we have reading lights. It's hard to read fine detail like text. We need those high spatial frequencies to help us discriminate the letters. And if the contrast is too low, then we just don't have enough sensitivity there and we're going to be straining to read. So it's nice to read in nice high luminance conditions to increase our contrast sensitivity.